Good morning and welcome to Calendar Bay Church Online. I'm Pastor John Intoff and thank you so much for joining us for our online service today. Hope that you had a great week as we wrapped up. Basically, it's not officially the end of summer, but as we move into Labor Day weekend, that's kind of the sense you have as the kids are going to be going back to school on Tuesday. So hope that your summer was good. And as we wrap things up, we're going to be heading back into kind of the regular swing of things here at Calendar Bay Church. As far as services go, you can continue to watch our service here online. All you have to do is, well, you can do it two ways. One, you can watch our YouTube premiere, which takes Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m. at our YouTube channel. And you can watch the service with others. After that point, it's available at any time, and you can watch the service at your own convenience. We also have our in-person worship service, which is starting at 10:30 a.m. on Sunday morning. And we're going to be having kids programming every other week. So it's going to be starting on September the 10th with Junior Church and Nursery, and then it'll be every other week. We're hoping to add on to that at some point, but right now that's as much staff as we have, and so that's what we're doing. So if you continue to watch the service online or you come in person, we just appreciate your connection here at Calendar Bay Church. If you'd like to get updates on the various things that are happening as we move into the fall, there's some small groups that are starting up. Women's Bible study is going to be starting up. There is going to be some other groups, men's ministry. Please be watching the bulletin. And so how you can get the bulletin, access to that, is by going to our website and going to calendarbaychurch.ca/bulletins, and you can get the most recent one and get caught up on the various things that are happening. So some exciting things happening as we head into the fall here at Calendar Bay Church, and so make sure you get the details on all of those. Thank you for your ongoing support of Calendar Bay Church, and if you would like to give to our ministry, there's a couple ways that you can do that. Number one, you can send your gift by mail, and all you have to do is sending it to our mailing address, which is Calendar Bay Church Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. Again, our mailing address, Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. Or you can give safely and securely online. All you have to do is go to our webpage, which is calendarbaychurch.ca/give, and it'll give you instructions on how to be able to do that. Thank you again for your faithful giving to Calendar Bay Church. We just appreciate your faithfulness in giving to the Lord through our ministry. Well, we want to celebrate around the Lord's table this morning. And so what I wanted us to do is just to prepare our hearts. If you haven't got some juice and bread prepared, you can just grab those at home and be prepared to be able to celebrate together. But as we do that, we want to sing this song. This song is a great song of reflection on the good things that God does in our lives. It's called 10,000 Reasons. And I just want you to be thinking of what are the reasons that you are thankful for this morning as we move into our communion time. So let's sing it together. Be thinking of those things as we prepare our hearts for communion.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 2,000 years and then forever.
I hope that you were able to take some time as we sang that song just to be able to reflect on the good things that God has done in your lives. As we celebrate around the Lord's table, it's really a wonderful thing as we contemplate the cross and the gift of Jesus to contemplate all the good things that God is doing in your life. And sometimes it's even good, you know, if maybe your life's been a little bit rough, you know, you're going through some things. The Bible says that God inhabits his praises, and we want to make sure that we take time to praise him and to worship him, because it does our heart good. It does the heart of God good, and we are able to be able to give him full praise for all that he does. And so as we contemplate together, I want you to be thinking about what it is that God has been doing in your life and to give thanks for that. Let's just take a moment in quiet and reflect on those things. God, we are so grateful as we celebrate today the gift of your Son. We thank you for the life that that brings to each one of us, for the many good things that you bring each and every day. Even when we walk through difficult times, James tells us we should consider things pure joy, because you're working out your purposes in our lives. And sometimes that's what we need to focus on, the fact that even in the midst of the difficult and the hard, you are still working out your purposes in our lives. You are causing us to grow in our faith. You are causing us to be more like you. And God, as we move into this fall season, we're going to see your beauty displayed in so many different ways, and we give you thanks for that. God, for your daily direction, for our health and our strength, for our family and our friends. God, we have so many things that we are grateful for. And today we celebrate the fact that you came to this earth to die for us so that we could have life. And as we partake together, it's with an overwhelming sense of gratefulness for the gift that you gave in Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of our sins, the redemption of our souls, and the promise of eternal life. And so as we eat together, it is with grateful and glad hearts. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's eat together. Jesus also, on the night that he was betrayed, took the cup. So this cup represents the new covenant that is in my blood. And every time you drink of it, do it in remembrance of me. And so as we partake together, we just want to take the opportunity to pray for any needs that you might have. And so I want you to be thinking of any need that you have right now, and just to lift that up to the Lord. And so maybe just in your home right now, just lift those things up. Just be thinking about them and lift them up, like using your hands as an image of just presenting these things to God. God, we are so grateful for the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We are thankful for your ongoing work in our lives. We are thankful that your word encourages us to be able to give those things which are concerning us to you. And God, right now, we just want to lift up to you those life situations that are just overwhelming right now. Whether they be family situations, legal situations, so many different things that can overwhelm us. God, we just want to lift them up to you. And we know that in the midst of that, you can give us peace, that you can give us strength, that you can give us everything that we need in that moment. God, for some of us, there are physical needs in our lives that we just need to have a touch from you. God, maybe there's somebody else in our life that needs to have a physical touch from you. God, we know that you are the great healer, the one who can work great and marvelous things. And so, God, we just lift those things up to you. God, as we have gone into the fall, many people might be overwhelmed with anxiety as they go into new situations, new environments, that they just need to know that you are with them. And so, God, I pray that that would be a reality. For those that over the long term have continued to struggle with depression and anxiety, God, we lift them up to you, knowing that you are able to work in ways that doctors cannot, and the ways that we cannot begin to, fix it ourselves. God, we look to you. God, for any other need that we have, we just give it to you. We know that you are able. We know that you are strong. And so, God, we give it to you. God, we are so thankful for the shed blood of Jesus Christ, for the ultimate work that that does in our soul, and the forgiveness that it brings, and the freedom that it brings, and the joy that it brings, and the blessing that it brings. And so, God, we thank you for dying for us on the cross. We thank you for the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness we have because of it. And as we drink together, it's with an overwhelming sense of gratefulness, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's drink together. We want to continue to worship. And this song is just a beautiful reminder of God's coming to earth to be the man of sorrows. And he died on a rugged cross so that we could have life. Let's sing it together.
Heaven, God's own son, to pray.
Going to finish up a series of messages looking at the life of David, and in many ways there is so much more we could do. There's so many different lessons, and actually, you know, if you go through the series so far, we haven't even got him to the throne yet. He's actually been, you know, fighting Goliath, running from Saul, learning all the lessons that needs to be learned there. And finally, we want to get him to the point where we're going to talk a little bit about when he does get to the throne, because there's something interesting that takes place in his life. And as we look at the scripture, this is what it says in 2 Samuel 5, 4 and 5. Now, David was 30 years old when he became king, so he's been on the run for that period of time. And so finally, you know, when he met Goliath, he was between 15 and 17. So he's been on the run for a period of time. And so David was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned over 40 years. In Hebron, he reigned over Judah 7 years and in 6 months, and in Jerusalem, he reigned over all Israel and Judah 33 years. Now, just to give you a little bit of an understanding of that passage of scripture, the first 7 and a half years, he actually is just the king of Judah. Which is the tribe he's a part of. And so Judah establishes its own throne in Hebron. And so that's where he's king. He doesn't get the sense that he's supposed to go to Jerusalem and take over everything, that he's supposed to go and establish himself first and not look like he's too anxious to take over the throne of Israel. And so that's what takes place. And Psalm 78 sums it up very well. The whole life of David. And this is what it says in Psalm 78. He chose David, his servant, and took him from the sheep pens. That's the, you know, when he left the sheep to go fight Goliath. He goes from tending the sheep, and he brought him to the shepherd of Israel, Jacob, or the people, Jacob of Israel, his inheritance. And so here we have the image of him being a shepherd, moving to being the shepherd of all of Israel. And then he did, they tell how did it go? And David shepherded them with integrity of heart, with skillful hands, and he led them. And David, his track record is going to show a number of things. His accomplishments that he made during his time as king are quite remarkable. David's accomplishments includes he expands the border of Israel. This period of time when King David and his son King Solomon are on the throne are called the Golden Age. It's when Israel was at its best. And David was a big part of that. He expanded the borders of Israel, and he was able to bring the kingdom of Israel to its height. He also was a good business guy. He set up extensive trade routes, and he introduced a time of great prosperity for the kingdom of Israel. And he also led into a spiritual revival. He unified the nation under Jehovah and created a national interest in spiritual things. And so at that time, there were a lot of different beliefs, as there were different kingdoms all around, and they all kind of threw hodgepodge all their religious stuff together into one pot. And David said, no, that stuff's not going to be allowed here. It's only going to be the worship of Jehovah our God. And so he establishes that. And it is the greatest point as far as worship of God in the middle of it. And so as we reflect on the life of David, we see that the first part of David's life is a model of character and integrity. The last part, not so much. As David gets onto the throne, there's a new challenge that David's life is, it seems to be moving from the challenge of Goliath to the challenge of being on the run to now the challenge of living in a time of prosperity. And what we discover, and this is an interesting truth, is that often we are better at handling afflictions than promotion. And what that means is that when you are, you know, digging in and working hard and fighting, that oftentimes that can be a time when you're really working together. But when things are going well, there's new temptations that come your way. I've seen this on a number of levels. I know I've talked to my dad about what was life like after World War II. And he said that actually there was this more greater sense of unity when they were in wartime situations till afterwards. Afterwards was difficult and it was hard. And many left places in Europe because it was just not the same. The struggle unified, the aftermath not so much. I've seen it with married couples that, you know, they, when they're young and it's hard and they're scratching to make ends meet, they stick it out. But as things become, you move to a time of affluence and prosperity, oftentimes relationships fall apart. Because there is problems that happen, and I'm going to call it in David's life, the trial of success. Sometimes when you become successful, even in the story of Saul, Saul's beginnings were good, but as success began to happen, he began to believe his own hype. Here we see some of the same thing happening in the life of David. And as David, who has had this great time of integrity and following hard after God, finally gets to the throne, we begin to see some cracks in his humanity. And there are three major flaws that begin to show up in David's life. The first one is this. He became so involved in public pursuits that he lost his family. If you go through the life of David, his family situation was complicated. Number one, when you start breaking some of God's rules as far as family, you end up with complicated situations. You know, oftentimes our family situations in modern times, you know, are complicated because, well, the original idea was is that you marry one person and you stayed with that person and you stayed as a family unit. But now it's kind of more complicated. David's situation is complicated times 10. Many wives, many kids, different, you know, it's very, very complicated. And he's the king, so he's a busy guy. He's working a lot. And it causes problems. And so his public pursuits end up that he's not able to manage his own household. This is a trend that we see not only in the life of David, but in many others as well. Number two, he indulged himself in extravagant extremes of passion. As things became more peaceful in his own life, he began to go thrill-seeking in other places. And that thrill-seeking began to cause all sorts of other problems. And we're going to take a closer look at some of that, because this is where the real slide begins to happen in his life. And we see that David, he becomes a victim of his own self-sufficiency and pride. As you begin to believe the own hype, you know, you begin to think that, you know what, I am. As things go well, you go, I am a good king. I'm doing a great job. And you start to believe your own hype. And so you start to become far more self-sufficient. And in 2 Samuel 24, very interesting situation where David actually says to one of his guys, let's count up how many people we got in my armed forces, because my armed forces is the best. And so I want to know how many I've got, because this is my army that I built. And it ends up being a very difficult time because David is showing his own self-sufficiency and pride. And so these three flaws, public pursuits over family, moving towards his passions, becoming more self-sufficient and proud, these become major problems. And out of those flaws, we see two timeless truths from Scripture. Number one, no pursuit is more important than the cultivation of a godly family. You know, Jesus says, what good is it a man if he gains the whole world but forfeits his own soul? And I've often said, you know, you could add another piece to that. And what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and lose his own family? And that's exactly what happened in the life of David. Is that by losing his family, he begins to lose his kingdom, and his kids begin to lose their faith. I read an interesting article this week. I might post this somewhere because I just found it to be very fascinating, just because there's so much happening in our society about dads not being active in the lives of their kids and the impact that that has. And there's a psychologist from New York who said this. His name is Dr. Paul Fitz. And he said, when a child is not able to form a healthy attachment to his or her father, it often manifests itself in the latter loss of faith. Interesting. No father, no heavenly father. No earthly father, no connection to the heavenly father. And that just seems to be, this is what we're seeing as kids don't have a relationship with their father. We've seen a loss of connection to faith and Heavenly Father. So this is an important principle. No pursuit in life is worth it if ultimately we lose our families. The second truth is this: genuine integrity is essential to the spiritual journey. We need to maintain a sense of integrity as we go along the spiritual journey. David, in his younger years, was absolutely, you know, we looked at him when he was, everybody is telling him to kill Saul. And he says, no, I will not attack God's chosen person. I'm not going to do it. And he handles himself with absolute and utter integrity. But integrity is interesting. Just because you had it doesn't mean that you're going to have it in the future. And David, we begin to see that in his life, he starts to make decisions that wear away the very integrity that was so essential to him being a man after God's own heart. And if we want to maintain a life of godliness, it is essential that we maintain a sense of integrity, that we are who we say we are, we do the things that are right, even if they're costly. We will choose to do what God wants more than we will choose our own agenda. We will live our lives with absolute and utter integrity. And just as we kind of wrap things up here, I want to look at three lasting lessons learned at David's expense. Three lasting lessons learned. That's a mouthful. Three lasting lessons learned at David's expense. And the first one is this: prosperity and ease are perilous times, not merely blessing. Prosperity and ease are perilous times, not merely blessing. And this goes against everything that we're kind of taught in North America. We connect blessing with good things. That the blessings are the, you know, prosperity, money, all that. But Jesus himself said it's hard for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. Why? Because prosperity and ease make you more self-sufficient and self-dependent, and it makes you less dependent on God. And so oftentimes, and this is what we don't realize, because we live in very affluent place. And we think, wow, boy, isn't that great. But why is it that when we live in this life of affluence, that we see spirituality declining? It's because prosperity and ease is not an easy spiritual adventure. It's actually one of the greatest trials that you will ever face, because if you get on the treadmill of getting stuff, what happens? Your life is consumed with more, more, more. And David had a worse time in his spiritual life in times of prosperity than he did when he was struggling and wrestling and needing to depend on God. When he reaches rock bottom, he discovers that God is still there. The problem is when you live in times of prosperity, you don't need to look to see if God's there because things are okay. And this is one of the greatest trials that you will ever face in your spirituality. It's interesting. C.S. Lewis, in his classic work, The Screwtape Letters, it's a letter of a demon writing to his subordinate, his junior, on how, in order to be able to work against humans. And this is what the older one says to the younger one. He says this: the long, dull years of middle-aged prosperity are excellent campaign weather. And so what he's saying is if you want to attack somebody, hit them in the middle-aged years of prosperity, because they will not see it coming. They thought that you were fighting hard when it was young and you were struggling and all those things, but hit them when things are good. And that's exactly the lesson that we learned from David. David wasn't prepared for the spiritual battles that take place during times of prosperity. The second principle that we want to pull out is that sinful behavior is generally a process, not a sudden act. In David's life, he had been very good, but then there were some subtle flaws and little things that began to happen. The first one was he had one wife, and well, then you add another wife, and then, well, you add another one. And there were these little things that began to happen, which began to become problems in his life. And these eventually lead to bigger problems. As we look at David's life, we see the anatomy of failure. David's downfall was not determined by one fatal mistake. You know, it's not as if he just did one thing. It was a series of increasingly unwise and selfish decisions. So he wasn't doing what was wise, and he began to do things for his own agenda, not the agenda of God. But we ultimately see one of his biggest failures. Now, one of his biggest failures was Bathsheba. Now, Bathsheba was a woman that David had an affair with. And it's interesting, as you see in David's life, that in one moment, he goes from one sin to basically to breaking three of the Ten Commandments in a very short period of time. Now, this is really, one moment leads to three major problems. The first was he is out looking and he sees Bathsheba and he wants her. The Bible calls that, King James language, coveting. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife. So he saw somebody else's wife, he desired her, and he got her. In that moment, he moves from sin number one, which is coveting, to number two, which is adultery. So he commits adultery. She becomes pregnant, then becomes problem number three. What are you going to do with husband? Your child is now going to be going son to another man. How do you handle this? And so David actually creates a whole situation in order to be able to murder Bathsheba's husband, Uriah. And so David, who had been kind of toying with some sins, just continues on. And the continuation was he wanted Bathsheba. He had already a bunch of other wives, but he wanted another one. And in that moment, he goes down a path. Goes from coveting to adultery to murder. Most of us don't think that our little things that we're doing, those little wee sins that we're doing, are going to be a problem. I remember hearing a speaker, this was when I was in high school. I was at a missionary church volleyball tournament. That's going way, way back. And I was a student, and the guy talked about how he had gone skiing, and he went down a black diamond, which is a really bad hill, and he wasn't that experienced, and he was starting to go down. He thought he was doing okay, and he lost his footing, and he wiped out. And as he sat there in the snow, he looked back, and he saw how far he had wiped out, the distance from when he started wiping out until where he was now, crashed on the ground. And he reflected and he said, you know what? Sometimes we will do little sins and we don't think that they're doing any harm. But when we start to let them take root, you will be amazed at how far you will fall. And that's the lesson that we learn from David. David's began to toy in things that he shouldn't have been toying with. And as he did this, it led him to a crash which would have been far beyond anything that he would have been expecting. And so we have to be careful. The third principle is that confession and repentance help bring healing, but they will never erase the scars. Can God do a miraculous work and bring healing in your life? Yeah, he can. But sometimes you have things happen in your life when you start to fall from where you once were. there are repercussions. In David's life, the son died. He eventually loses, because he wanted to establish the temple. That was one of the things that was him. But David is told in this, the sword will never leave your hand, which means that he is going to be fighting for the rest of his life. And you're never going to be able to be that spiritual builder that you always wanted to be. You know what? Psalm 51 is actually a reaction to the story of Bathsheba, and it goes through this whole beautiful prayer of forgiveness and healing, and God can bring forgiveness and healing in our lives. But the full impact of the things that we do, and sometimes the impact of our behaviors, are real living people, real living situations. You know what? If you start messing around and your marriage falls apart, there is an impact on your life forever. It's you're never going to be able to redeem that. It's gone. And I don't say that to be depressing and because God can do incredible, marvelous things. But just to say that if you mess around with the principles of God, there is impact in your life and on your future. You can't toy with the things of God and expect there to be no repercussions in your life. And let me just leave you with three things that we need to do in order to protect ourselves. Because in David's life, his greatest difficulties happened when he had his time of prosperity. And if we want to continue to be, and in David's life, the end of his life was not as great as his beginning. He didn't finish really, really well. And we want to make sure that on our spiritual journey, we finish really, really well. So let me just leave you with these things. If we want to be people after God's own heart, number one, guard your home. In David's life, it became one of the biggest problems as they had, his son tried to overthrow him, Absalom. He had a problem with one of his own kids raping his daughter. It's awful, the things that took place in David's life. And David needed to focus more on governing his household and taking care of his household. And we too need to make sure that we are focusing on building our homes. And so whether you're parents, grandparents, let's make sure that we guard our homes. Guard our families. Pray for our families. Do those things that only you can do. As a grandparent, there are some things that only you can do. As a parent, there are some things that only you can do. You can't depend on others to do it for you. You got to make sure that those are the things that you're taking care of. Number two, guard your heart. It's the little breaches in integrity that can lead to catastrophic failure. And it's during that time of prosperity. It is when things are going good, as C.S. Lewis says, that the greatest attacks can happen and can destroy your marriage. It can destroy your ministry. There are so many guys that are in professional ministry that at the end of their life, they crashed and burned because of a lack of integrity along the way. There were little things that began to happen, manipulations of power, thinking that they were, you know, like David, started to be self-sufficient, started to depend upon themselves, don't need to have accountability, don't need those things. And eventually, it led to the demise of their ministry. There are certain ministries that they had to take the name of the original founder out of it because the devastation was too much. So guard your heart. Watch that you don't have little breaches in your integrity, because ultimately it's those little breaches that can lead to catastrophic failure. And lastly, the third principle, guard your days. If you really want to finish well, it is going to come down to dependence. Daily dependence on God. Because God is interested in wanting us to finish well on the spiritual journey. He doesn't merely want us to kind of fade into the end. He wants us to make sure that we live each and every day with integrity and dependence on Him. That we live for Him every single day, and we watch that we don't have breaks in our integrity, that we make sure that our families are cared for. We do the things that God is calling to us, because David, this beautiful man after God's own heart, and this testimony of all the work that God did through him, towards the end, he started to crash. Let's protect ourselves from the crash. The life of David has so much that we can learn. But the one thing that we can learn to make our lives even greater is to finish well. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are able to depend on you on a daily basis. God, help us to guard our families. Help us to guard our integrity. Help us to guard our days so that we will be dependent on you each and every day. God, we pray that you would help us to be able to be men after your people, after your own heart. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. As we conclude the service, we want to sing this great song. And this song is about giving our heart to God. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Make this your prayer as we sing it together, that our hearts would be so desiring to live for him, that we would have no breaches of integrity, and that we would be able to serve him fully until our final breath. Let's sing this. Make it your prayer. Thank you so much for being a part of our online service today. If you are watching the YouTube premiere, I would encourage you just to enjoy a time of conversation as we close the service. There'll be a couple minutes where you can interact with one another, depending on your device, so it'll either be on the side or down below. And let's just encourage one another. Again, thank you for being here today. And I would encourage you, let's live our lives full of integrity. If you want to find out things that are going on at the church this week, make sure that you go to our website, calendarbaychurch.ca/bulletins, and learn more about what's happening here. God bless you. Hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful week.
my soul.